question as I begin this morning. Have you ever had the experience of being treated unjustly? Of suffering for no fault of your own? Ever had that experience? Any of you? Have you ever said... You hear that? Hey, little girl. Oh, she's not talking today. Oh, poor little girl. I've worked hard to get this girl to come and say this for me.
She didn't talk the first time.
She did say the first time.
Heard her, yeah.
Well, I guess she figures you...
Yeah, it's just not fair.
It's not fair. Well, anyways, well, I've had that experience. It was back in high school. This was my high school physics teacher. His name was Mr. Legibokov. Big, burly guy. I remember he always wore suits that were about three sizes too small. And everything kind of bulged out on him everywhere. But anyways, and that's a picture of me. Actually, I didn't get my grade 11 picture. That's my grade 12 picture. And one day, when I was grade 11, he called me into his office and he began to literally just to ream me up. And he was quite exasperated with me. And in his verbal blast, he drew attention to something that I knew I had not done. I tell you what, I cannot honestly remember what it was that he was accusing me of. I've already forgotten that. But I knew this, it wasn't something I'd done. Now, I'd done lots of things. I'll have to admit I wasn't exactly the most well-behaved student in school. And I remember one time he really reamed me out for climbing out of the window from in our grade 9 classroom and doing that in the middle of the day, and he was not pleased with me. But in this case, I knew that I had not done it. I remember I just really, really strongly protested my innocence to him, and I said I never did it. And I remember as he was accusing me of this, I had this feeling just sweeping over me of injustice. And I remember thinking, I'm being blamed for something I didn't do. And it was a terrible feeling. Now, I guess, given my track record, it was kind of a logical one for him to accuse me of this particular thing. But fortunately for me, he did not listen. He listened to my protestations, and he seemed to be genuinely surprised by it, almost mystified. Really? You didn't do it? And I said, no. I didn't. And so that was my experience. I'll never forget that experience. And when that sort of thing happens to us, we all feel a keen sense of injustice in our lives. And children especially have that keen sense of injustice, kind of like the fact that when you treat one child, and I know Mike and Maria, you've got three kids, and if you give one kid an ice cream cone and not the other two are going to say? What do the other two say?
My brother has
blood sugar,
so he gets the treats.
Silas always gets the breaks. And Sadie, what do you say? It's not
fair.
It's not fair. That's right. Well, we are like that. I heard about the wise mother who got the biggest piece of two boys. She had two sons. They were fighting over the biggest piece of cake. And I think all of you mothers have done this. She told one son to cut the cake and the other son to have the first choice. And I was reading about one mother she tried this and she recommended trying it. She said, you'll be surprised how perfectly equal the pieces will be. It's probably true. And of course, that sense of unfairness is really seen in parental favoritism. And like Maria was saying, just because Silas has diabetes, he gets all these breaks and blood sugar and the rest of that kind of stuff. The story that we went through this morning was in the children's story about Joseph and his experience and how the brothers got angry at Joseph. It's interesting, they got mad at Joseph and not at their dad. You ever notice that? They blamed Joseph for his father's favoritism. And of course, you know, the story is it was told on the video, they threw him into the cistern. And then they sold him into slavery into Egypt. And during this entire experience, I mean, that was a tough thing for Joseph to go through. Scripture says in later on in the book of Genesis, the brothers say, remember when we sold him into slavery, how he was weeping and sobbing and crying and pleading with us. And then at that point in time, they're saying, now we're getting our comeuppance because of that. And of course, he went through this tremendous sense of injustice. This is unjust, what's happening to me. And of course, that was the tragic result of parental favoritism in his life. And hopefully next week we'll get the rest of the story on Joseph as we go through that. Anyways, our text this morning talks about experiencing injustice from others. And I like the Charlie Brown Peanuts cartoon, how he, and this one is over and over and over again, that Lucy is holding the football and he's supposed to kick it. And just when he does, she moves the football and he lands on his face. And over and over and over again, I mean, I've read the Peanuts cartoons for many years, and this is in every problem. Lucy always does it to Charlie. Anyways, our text is 1 Peter 2, 18 to 20. I'll read it, and then we'll have prayer. Let me read it before I pray. Slaves, submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how's it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. So I've entitled my message this morning, Suffering Unjustly. And as we begin, let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity to go verse by verse through the book of 1 Peter. And today as we look at verses 18 through 20 of chapter 2, and we look at the topic of being subject to unjust suffering. And we know that all of us have this keen sense of fair play within us, and we feel offended when we are feel that we don't get fair treatment. And we know that this is a challenge for all of us. And I pray this morning, especially as when we go through life and it seems that you treat us unfairly yourself and we kind of feel let down by you. And I pray that we might see your purpose and plan in all of these things. And as we look at this passage, guide and lead us into the truth. And I stand against all the forces of darkness. I command every evil spirit in the strong name of Jesus to go. And Holy Spirit, I welcome you here. Guide and lead us into the truth. And we will give you all the praise and glory in Christ's name. Amen. David Milgard was a 15-year-old boy who was just happened to be passing through Saskatoon on the day January 31st, 1969, when it was the same day that a nursing assistant by the name of Gail Miller had been raped and stabbed to death in a back alley. And they say on the basis of sketchy forensics and unreliable witnesses, Milgard was convicted of that crime. He was sentenced to life in prison January 31st, 1970. He was 16 years old when they did this, exactly a year after Miller's murder. And he ended up spending 23 years in jail for a crime he did not commit. And Milgard appealed his conviction a number of times, but was blocked. I remember when the Justice Minister was Kim Campbell, and it came to the Justice Minister, and it was really bungled a lot of times through the years. But finally, the Supreme Court of Canada reversed the decision, and a new trial was ordered. And they found in July 18th, 1997, that a DNA laboratory, and DNA was just becoming popular at that point in time, and they confirmed that the semen samples on Gail Miller's clothing was not Milgard's, but it was someone else's, a fellow by the name of Fisher, forget his first name. And he was eventually convicted and sent to jail for the crime. The Saskatchewan government then apologized for the wrongful conviction. But imagine, 22, 23 years, you're in jail, something you never did. You're totally innocent of. And by that time, Milgard had become one of the most famous examples of wrongful conviction in Canada. He was compensated, actually, $10 million for that, but you know, money never replaces lost life, as you can imagine. How many of you remember the rock band Tragically Hip? All right, some of you do. The Tragically Hip. Well, their album Fully and Completely. Yes, Ken is going to run this song. And for all of you Tragically Hip fans, I'll play. We'll play this for you. You got it there, Ken? Singing there too. I had to endure that. But my apologies to all the wheat, to the tragically hip fans. That's the song Wheat Kings. Well, our text talks about suffering and justice. So we're going to look at this idea of unjust suffering. And in our context, Peter is going to talk to slaves who are experiencing such treatment from the hands of their masters. Verse 18. Slaves, submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. Now, I know some folks will struggle and do struggle, and I know one of the criticisms of Christianity that some people have is the fact that the Bible seems to condone, if not oppose, not only not oppose slavery, but seem to condone it, or maybe even some would see it as approving slavery. And they struggle with that. So this morning I want to begin by first looking at this idea of what the Bible says about slavery and the context of the scriptures as to how slavery is seen. Now in the first century, slavery was an economic reality. All across the Roman world, people were slaves. And the New Testament talks about frequently talks about slaves and slavery. And particularly their relationship with their masters, like in this text. For example, look at Ephesians 5, 6, verse 5. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Colossians 3, 22. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything and do it not only when their eye is on you to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. 1 Timothy 6, 1, let all who are under a yoke as slaves regard their own masters as worthy of all honor, so the name of God and the teaching of God may not be reviled. As a matter of fact, one whole book in the New Testament, the book of Philemon, it's only a one-chapter book, deals with a slave owner by the name of Philemon, who has a runaway slave, and the runaway slave's name is Onesimus. And Onesimus runs away from Philemon, goes to Rome, and there he meets up with Paul, who is in prison at that point in time. How that happened, we're not told. And then Paul ends up leading him to the Lord and then sends him back to Onesimus, to Philemon, sends Onesimus back to Philemon and says to Philemon, take him back. And he says to him, and he puts it this way, no longer as a slave, but as a better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a man, as a brother in the Lord. In other words, now Onesimus was not just a slave of Philemon, he was now a brother in Christ. And that new relationship be formed because of Onesimus' decision to accept Christ. Now in their thinking, a lot of people today compare slavery in Israel to the slavery that we are all acquainted with in America. That the black people, and particularly in the Deep South, suffered prior to the Civil War, and of course all of that attendant cruelty. Look at this picture here of a slave auction. Husbands, wives, and families sold indiscriminately to different purchasers are violently separated, probably never to meet again. And so I think you will agree with me when we say this kind of slavery is totally, was and is totally wrong. But slavery in the Old Testament times was actually, you might be interested in knowing, quite different. There was a couple of ways in which you could become a slave. One, of course, would be that you could be born into a slave family. Your mom and dad were slaves, and you were born into that family, and you became a slave because of that. And another one, which was the fact that through poverty or debt. And so that people would then be sold as slaves to pay their debts. Exodus 21:2 says, when you buy a Hebrew slave. Matthew 18, Jesus talks about the parable of the man who's not willing to forgive. And it says, and since he was not able to pay, the master ordered he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt, sold into slavery. Now, at that time, for the most part, this was a fairly good provision, because in Israel, those who bought slaves were actually helping them out of their current financial distress, and it kind of gave these people guaranteed employment. And as a matter of fact, it was an alternative to having to beg and experience destitution. Leviticus 25, 39 and 40, if one of your countrymen becomes poor among you and sells himself to you, do not make him work like a slave. He is to be treated as a hired worker and a temporary resident among you. And so really, slavery was kind of a safety social net in the first century. Today, when people get into massive debt like this, they claim bankruptcy. Well, they didn't have bankruptcy in those days. And this was the option you had, and it preserved your life. In most cases, that ended up being like an employer-employee relationship. Now, the one thing the Bible is very clear on, it was the condemnation of the oppression of slaves. And it constantly urged humane treatment. Look at what Deuteronomy 5 says, and this is in the fourth commandment regarding the Sabbath day. The seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your male servant or your female servant, so that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well as you. And so the reason why they were to do this was because they were to remember they themselves had been slaves back in Egypt and had come into the promised land. And so now, whenever you had someone who couldn't survive financially, you bought him as a slave, helped him through that tough time, and in so doing, you treated them properly. And so the regulations that God gave the Israelites in the Old Testament showed to me he wanted the Israelites to treat their slaves as humans, not as property. And that's the difference between biblical slavery in the Bible and slavery elsewhere. Now, furthermore, a slave was to be seen as a member of the family. Literally, the word household is used. And as such, he was protected. All his needs for food and clothing were provided for. And so, as I said before, those who bought slaves were actually helping them out of their current financial distress. And as slave owners, they were to see these folks essentially like a hired hand, kind of like Mike Jansen works for his boss. In one way, in biblical times, Mike would be called a slave in that context, although the involvement of having been sold, because you were in major debt, were you? When you... Maybe you were.
I still am working.
So it says, if one of your countrymen becomes poor among you and sells himself to you, do not make him work as a slave. He is to be treated as a hired worker or a temporary resident among you. And so today we see this kind of slavery as losing your self-esteem. And in those days they did not, rather, because they saw it as saving them, as I've said, from destitution. And so doing, it was preserving their self-respect as people. They were not lower class in any way. It was a way of coping with that reality. Now, by the time you get into the New Testament, we do not see, with slavery then spread, of course, all over the world. And of course, Israel was no longer an independent state. And slavery was a part of the Roman Empire. There was probably more slaves than free people in the time of the Roman Empire. And it's interesting, when you get to the New Testament, there's no call to overthrow slavery. And a lot of people struggle with this. And the response that most of us have, as we've studied this, have suggested, is by its teaching on the dignity and equality of all human beings. Galatians 3:24 says, for there is neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, bond nor free. In other words, in God's sight, there is no difference. We're all equal in God's sight. And so it set the stage for this to ultimately happen. And we know that this was what happened for example, with the work of William Wilberforce in the 18th century, and his desire to get rid of the horrible slavery of that time, the African slaves being taken to America and other parts of the world, came as a result of his personal relationship with God. He was a born-again evangelical Christian, converted in 1784-85. And it was in 1787, as a Christian, that he effected the Society for the, he founded the Society for Effecting the Abolition of the Slave Trade, more commonly called the Anti-Slavery Society. He was actually very good friends with John Newton. John Newton is the man who wrote the word, the song Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace. And he was a slave trader before he became a Christian. And he became a pastor then, and he actually had Wilberforce in his church. And Wilberforce was a child. And picture here is of them discussing Wilberforce the politician with Wesley the pastor. And so it was July 26, 1833, that the Slavery Abolition Act was passed in the British House of Commons, and slavery was abolished in most British colonies. 800,000 slaves were freed in the Caribbean, South Africa, as well as a number in Canada. It's interesting that Wilberforce lived to see this happen, and 3 days later he died, and he was interred in Westminster Abbey. And so as a consequence, the institution of slavery was forever changed. Well, we had still the Civil War as well in the States in 1860, and that's when slavery became illegal in the States. I want to say this, though. Do you realize that we live in a day when slavery is still very real? Did you know that? In modern-day terms, the practice of slavery is not called slavery. It's called human trafficking. That's the phrase that's used. But really, human trafficking and slavery, they're synonyms. They mean and refer to the same thing. One website I visited on this topic of human trafficking said, and I quote, "Slavery did not end in the 19th century. Today there are more slaves in the world than ever before." Did you know that? They say there's around 40 million people today who are enslaved around the world. One in every 200 people today is a slave. And they say there are four categories of slavery today. First one, child exploitation. And there are 8.4 million currently suffering exploitation all over the world. One in four modern slavery victims is our children. There are 4.4 child victims for every 1,000 children in the world. 37% of these are forced to marry, are children. Children account for 18% of persons in private forced labor, and 21% of victims of the sex trade are children. And then they say there's forced labor. About 20 million people are in forced labor. 16 million are in the private sector, and 4 million in the state-sponsored forced labor. And 57% of these are women. And most victims suffer from multiple forms of coercion, including the withholding of wages, threats or acts of violence against them and their family. And the third area, which is not slavery, but it's a sub-form of slavery, is organ trafficking. And they say that kidneys make 75% of the global illicit trade in organs. And they'll take people and forcibly take from them their organs and then sell them on the black market. 10,000 kidneys sold on the black market every year. And then, of course, the saddest one, of course, is sexual exploitation. 4.8 million are enduring sexual exploitation. 99% of victims of the sex trade are women and children. More than 7 in 10 victims are exploited in Asia and the Pacific region. You go to Thailand and Laos and those countries, it's just horrible there. 54% of trafficking victims are trafficked for the sex trade. And the sex trade makes an approximately $99 billion per year. And you know, that's the sad reality of the sinful world we live in today. Still happening, even as we speak. Well, that's the background, slavery. Now I want to get into the main context of what I'm saying, how we should respond to slavery. Last week we were talking about being in submission to those in authority. Here's a picture of the slide that I used in relating and talking about our relationship as Christians to governing authorities and how that we are to be in submission to them. 1 Peter 2:13, submit yourself for the Lord's sake to every authority instituted among men. And I said, we submit even though we don't necessarily agree with all of their political positions. And we talked about that. That video is online. You can watch it on our New Life YouTube channel and see it for yourself. Well, our text here right now goes on to say in verse 18, in the same way we are to submit to governing authorities, now he addresses slaves and says, slaves, submit yourselves to your masters. Now, many Christians in the first century who people became Christians were actually household slaves. And so I think it's only appropriate that Paul should address them in their specific needs. And actually, he does that in Colossians, he does that in Ephesians, and also 1 Timothy, Paul talks about it there. And they were given this mandate of submitting to and respecting their masters. And for Christian slaves, it'd be probably, if you had a good slave, it wouldn't be hard to submit. A master who was kind and gentle. But the question is, what do you do about those guys who are harsh and mean? And yet it's interesting that in the context it says that that's exactly what was expected of them. As Peter puts it, that slaves are to submit to their masters. Let me read it for you exactly the way he phrases it. Slaves, submit yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. And so, for sure, there were at least some Christian slaves who would have had masters who were cruel and unjust in the first century and who had to endure mean and harsh treatment from them. For example, in the article online in the Roman Empire in the first century, talking about slaves and freemen, it said life as a slave. All slaves and their families were the properties of their owners. It's the first century. And they could sell or rent them out at any time. Their lives were harsh. Slaves were often whipped, branded, or cruelly mistreated. Their owners could also kill them for any reason and would face no punishment. That's slavery in the first century in the Roman Empire. Not in Israel, but in the Roman Empire. Now, in this context, these Christian slaves are being mistreated for a very unique reason, and that is for their godly lives and their Christian testimony. And they were being mistreated for doing good. Notice how it says, but if you suffer for doing good and you endure, this is commendable before God. So there's a unique aspect to the suffering here, that you're doing the right thing and yet you get punished for it. Now, Peter was urging these slaves in the context of suffering unjustly to not give up their Christian faith and principles, but rather to endure. I want you to notice the repetitive use of the word endure. 1 Peter 2, 19 and 20. For it's commendable that if a man bears up, that's a synonym to endure, under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for good and you endure it, then this is commendable before God. And so the concept of what Peter is saying here, put up with it, bear with it, endure. Don't quit, don't throw in the towel and say, that's it, I'm a Christian, God's not taking care of me, I'm backing out. A lot of people do. When they go through injustice, they say, forget it, I'm not gonna hang in there, I'm giving up Christianity. And so even to these cruel and harsh masters, Christian slaves were to submit. Now I know a lot of people, you know, say that this is ridiculous. It sounds ridiculous, you should, common sense to you should rebel. Well, I want to look at the question of this. We know we should respond, and Peter's talking to us as Christians, that we respond to unjust suffering by enduring. How do you do so? And Peter gives the how of experiencing suffering unjustly. How? And the answer is in verse 19, by being conscious of God. Notice how it puts it in verse 19, for it's commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering, because he is conscious of God. You see, the ability to bear up patiently under unjust suffering comes, as a believer, by our conscious awareness of God's presence in our lives. And we are aware that God is with us in the midst of our suffering, and that we think of God while we go through this terrible, difficult time in our lives. We keep our focus on God, not on the suffering. Get it? New Century Version puts it this way, a person might have to suffer even when it is unfair, but if he thinks of God and stands the pain, God is pleased. And so this happens, the way we can, by being conscious of God, is that we realize that God is completely sovereign in all of the events of life, His sovereignty extends even over the unjust suffering. In other words, when you suffer unjustly, God's not saying, oh, wow, how did that happen? He's not caught off guard by it. The sovereignty of God means God completely knows everything. Same thing with this pandemic. You think God is saying, oh, wow, look what's happening on planet Earth. There's a virus. It's called COVID-19. Wow. What are we going to do next? He's not biting his fingernails with his teeth. He's sovereign. The sovereignty of God means he's over everything. Not only knows everything, he's in control. Nothing happens that catches God off guard. He's not surprised by what's happening in your life, the suffering you're going through. He knows it. He's aware. All of the events of your life, God is aware of them. He knows. And the more wonderful thing is that he takes and uses it for good. Oh, I love this. Romans 8:28, and we know that God causes. Notice there the word cause. If I cause something, it means I make it happen, right? God causes all things to work together for good. So how does he do that? Well, that's the amazing thing about God. You just stand back and watch and think, wow, wow, wow. Look at how he worked it out. It's amazing. And it really is. It is amazing. According, God caused all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. I love God and I'm called according to his purpose, so it's working out for my good. So therefore, when I know that, that is what helps me to handle the tough stuff of life. You see? That's what helps me handle the tough stuff of life. Now, secondly, why does God want us to endure patiently under unjust suffering? And the answer is because that's exactly what causes him to sit up and take notice of. When he sees you enduring, not caving in, not throwing in the towel, he says, ah, I like that. Oh, I see that in you. You're not caving in. You're hanging in there. And then later on in verse 20, our text, he says, but how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it, but if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. Now, here's Peter's point, is that if you're being beaten because you're doing something wrong, you deserve that beating. If you're robbing your boss and then you're getting punished because of that, you're not suffering as a Christian. That's not called suffering as a Christian. As a matter of fact, that's something we as Christians should never be guilty of, is doing a wrong that deserves punishment. I should never do anything wrong that causes somebody to have to punish me. Obviously, that's there. 1 Peter 4:15-16, if you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. Notice that's chapter 4, and we're going to come to that later on when we get to chapter 4. And so what he's saying is that no credit accrues for enduring punishment for doing wrong. You know, and some of the tough things we go through in life comes because of our own wrongdoing, our own stupidity. I was watching a thing on videos called on YouTube, and it's called I'm having a senior moment here. Oh, good grief.
That's what happens when you're getting older.
Yeah, that's right. I had my birthday this week, so that's right. I can't remember the name of the video, but anyways, what they do, they set up the cameras in a house, and they go online, and guys who are online chatting with underage girls, and they have these people who pose as underage girls, and then the underage girl, and he comes to the house to meet the underage girl. And then the guy from 2020, I think it is, comes into the room and he says, after the girl walks out, the guy comes in, the girl greets him, the girl walks out, and this guy comes in and he says, oh, and why are you here? and what some of the guys actually, and they have a whole number of them, some of the guys actually try to, they leave the house right away, but they got police outside and they arrest them right away. So they're not getting away. And soliciting sex with a minor is the crime. And they even show him taken to the prison and put it put in you know, fingerprint and put in prison in jail overnight and that sort of thing. And it's quite interesting to watch the guys who are caught in the act of doing this. And most of them say, I am so stupid. I knew I shouldn't be doing this. I was an idiot. And so some of your suffering may be brought on yourself, okay? And that's, as Christians, we seek to live God-honoring lives that we don't bring the suffering on ourselves. So if you do something wrong, first, you deserve whatever comes your way. And second, it's no great achievement in life if you put up with the punishment that's meted out to you. If you go happily through the punishment you're getting, well, I mean, it's good. It's better going happy than it, but it's not a big deal. How's your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? And the answer is not. But on the other hand, it's respectful submission to undeserved. Notice the word there, undeserved suffering. That finds favor with God because such behavior demonstrates the grace of God. New Living Translation. But of course you get no credit for being patient if you are beaten for doing wrong. But if you suffer for doing right and are patient beneath the blows, God is pleased with you. And so this is the contrast. If you put up with suffering that you don't deserve, that's when God says, whoa, I like that. I am pleased. Now, what God notices highly and regards highly is the fact that we suffer for doing good and go through it without complaining, moaning, or groaning. For it's commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering. Today's English version puts it this way, God will bless you for this if you endure the pain of undeserved suffering. The Message paraphrases it this way, there's no particular virtue in accepting punishment you well deserve, but if you've been treated badly for good behavior and continue in spite of it to be a good servant, that's what counts with God. Interesting book called Living Sacrifice, written by Helen Rosevier, and she tells of her experience as a missionary in Congo, of Africa. I think they call it the Democratic Republic of the Congo now, DRC. But she was there for 20 years, 1953 and 1973. And she tells a story how that the government soldiers came to her place where she was living as a missionary. It says, and they came to my bungalow, ransacked it, then grabbed me. I was beaten and savagely kicked, losing my back teeth through the boot of a rebel soldier. They broke my glasses so I could not see to protect myself from the next blow. Then, one at a time, two army officers took me to my own bedroom and raped me. They dragged me out to a clearing, tied me to a tree, and stood around laughing. And while I was there, beaten and humiliated and violated, someone brought out the only existing handwritten manuscript of a book I had been writing about God's work in the Congo for over an 11-year period. And they put it on the ground in front of me and burnt it. And as Helen watched the book go up in smoke, she cried out to herself, she just wept. She said, I said to myself, was it worth it? 11 years of my life poured out for selfless service for the African people, and now this. And she said, the minute I said that, the Holy Spirit settled over that terrible scene, and he began to speak to me. And the Holy Spirit said, my daughter, the question is not, is it worth it? The question is, am I worthy? And she says, and God broke my heart, and I looked up and said, oh, Lord Jesus, yes, it is worth it, for you are worthy. And then the second reason God wants to suffer and endure unjust suffering is because he uses that suffering to build character into us so he can more effectively use us later. Romans 5, 3 and 4, not only so, we also rejoice at our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. James 1, 2 and 4, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. And perseverance must finish this work that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. A number of years ago, we had a guest speaker come to our church in Stonewall when I was the pastor there. And his name, a pastor friend of mine, said, you know, there's this Egyptian fellow who's got a phenomenal testimony, and he said, do you want to have him come to your church? He said, his name is Majid El Shafi. And I said, yeah, sure. I said, he told me a bit of his story. I remember we had him at, in the church and one evening there in Stonewall, and a group of people sat with bated breath as he told his story. And he had been born in Cairo. His parents were both, he came from a family, Muslim family of lawyers. And so he followed the footsteps of his fathers and uncles and became a lawyer himself. And he said, when I became a lawyer, he said, I suddenly became aware of the systemic persecution of Christians. Egypt is largely Muslim. There is a Christian population there. Coptic Christians make up, I think, a small percentage of the population. The vast majority of Egyptians are Muslim. And he said, I began to see this. I wonder why. Why are Muslims persecuting Christians? Why are they killing Christians? And he saw Christian churches destroyed. I found these two pictures just recently. This happened. Two churches in Egypt destroyed. You see the vandalism there and destruction. And as a result, he had a friend by the name of Tamir, who was a Christian. And through the witness of Tamir, Majid El-Safi became a Christian himself. He gave his life to Christ in service to the Lord. And he said he then immediately began a ministry. And he said in 2 years, that grew to 24,000 Christians. I mean, that's a phenomenal thing. When you consider in a country like Egypt, to have that kind of ministry. Well, the Egyptian government, when they saw that he was having such a successful ministry, they wouldn't tolerate it. And they threw him into prison, the Abu Zabal prison in Cairo, and they threw him into the torture section. And during his time in prison, Majid underwent 7 days of severe torture in the underground prison because they wanted him to give the names of the leaders of his illegal movement. And he wouldn't do that. He wouldn't do that. And so he told how that those 7 days, how they progressed. He said at the end of the second day, they told him the next day they would bring in the attack dogs. During the night that followed, he prayed and asked God to take his life now. When he awoke the next morning, he was mad at God for not taking his life. He could hear the dogs barking coming into his cell. He sat on the floor in the corner, covered his face with his arms, and waited. 3 dogs were brought in, he said, but instead of attacking, they simply sat in silence. You know, when I read that, I remember thinking of Daniel in the lion's den, almost identical story to that. And he goes on to say this, a second set of 3 dogs were brought in. The handlers beat the dogs, but they wouldn't do a thing to Majid. Finally, they left him alone for the rest of the day. On the 4th day, they took him to another cell where he was crucified by being tied to a cross. They put a rope around his neck that if he fell asleep, he would choke. They left him that way for 2.5 days with a mixture of salt and lemon to anoint his wounds. All this because of his newfound faith in the Lord. On the 7th day, they took him off the cross, put him in the hospital. I remember thinking, this is kind of weird. But they wanted to keep him alive as a political prisoner. And 3 months later, with the help of friends who stormed the prison, he escaped and came to Canada. That's where he got refugee status, here in Canada. And that led him to found a new human rights organization. If you Google this, it's all over the internet. It's called One Free World International. And it specializes in helping the persecuted church and persecuted believers all over the world. And he calls himself a freedom fighter. You see how God used that experience to bring about a phenomenal ministry? It was totally unjust suffering. But sometimes God's ways are just so much different than ours, but they're always for the best. Always for the best. And so that even though we may experience unjust suffering, if we endure patiently under it, God will use it for his glory and every time. Ephesians 1, in him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be for the praise of his glory. Father, we thank you for your word. I don't know what experience of suffering unjustly these people have gone through or are going through here this morning. Maybe none at all, maybe lots. whatever the case, Lord, I pray that when we go through times when we just don't seem to understand why, we've been doing the right thing and yet we're getting nailed hard. And we maybe sometimes feel like you've abandoned us and left us alone. And as the psalmist put it, why are you downcast, my soul? We can feel like you've left us all by ourselves, and yet we know you are always there. That there is no pit so deep, but that your love and your presence is deeper still, as Corrie ten Boom once put it. And Lord, we pray that as we go through these difficult times, we will see fruit accrue for your kingdom, as we see in the life of Eleanor Roosevelt and Helen Roosevelt, and as we see in the life of Majid El-Shafi, how that these two individuals went through horrible, horrible times, but yet you used them in a wonderful and a great and amazing way, and we know their reward will be great in heaven someday. But help us to be faithful, even during the tough times, so that your praise will be expanded. And this morning, we'll give you a chance, perhaps, as a moment of silence to ruminate over what I've shared. If God has spoken to you about a particular thing in your life, I just pray about it, deal with it, and then I'll close in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you that it has the truth we need for our lives. I pray for these people. Give them a real sense of joy and happiness as they go through life, whatever struggles they have. Lord, if there's someone here who's not yet accepted Jesus as personal Savior, we pray that today will be the day they make the decision to give their lives over to Christ, surrender to Him, and walk with Him. And Lord, for those who have, maybe going through tough times, feel suffering unjustly, help them to see the purpose you're accomplishing in their lives. And we'll give you all the praise and the glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. One final song by Brother Mike, and then our service is over.